you described the methodology I always talk to people about is you can either go faster or you can improve the situation, right? It's like,
if we can create just the right amount of healthy stress, the plants are going to reward us over and over again. That's what they're there to help us, and we're there to help them. I'm going to make a prediction for the future that sometime in the future, they're going to look at our age, look back at our age, how we abused the antibiotics, and they're going to say, what were they thinking?
So you're saying the plants that didn't have the inoculant were ended up robbing more of the microbes from the plants that were inoculated because it was in a recirculating system?
Biostimulants just don't increase the metabolism to plants. They also increase the metabolism to your microbiology. Please join us with Harley Smith on this amazing snippet from our 2-hour-long podcast. If you enjoyed this, make sure to follow at the end of this video for the full show. You're here with Mark Batwell on Perfect Gardens TV. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe, and make sure to check us out on Instagram, Facebook, and hit the notifications for future updates like this. Make sure to check out our monthly membership. For as little as $2.99 a month, you get access now to 105 members, 2,586 photos, 274 videos, 21 files, 1,106 shared links, and much, much more.
I was saying there's people who do try to do it themselves, like free and natural farming, like a plant extract, but they don't realize that they can produce a lot of ethanol in what they're producing, because the bacteria, it ends up producing that ethanol.
So they're producing moonshine. Producing moonshine with it. Nice.
Plants really don't like the moonshine. They don't like that.
I just want someone to act off of what I was saying, like just do FDE off.
A little secret here too. One of the products that they gave me the pure product to test ahead in my lab. It also speeds up the metabolism, not just of plant cells, but of the microorganisms in the roots. So it really has a double effect. You speed up the microorganisms, so their metabolism, they start vibrating with energy because they're feeding on the sugars more. And then they start dividing, pop, pop, pop. And as they divide, that's when they make the enzymes. That's when they make the organic acids. That's when they make the chelators that help with the uptake. That's when they make the growth hormones are in the roots. So it has a beneficial effect on the microorganisms. But the secret was, one of the things they were using it for, which is kind of weird, but they were using it with experimenting with chickens, poultry in India, where they were making this stuff, right? They'd add a drop of it to the water, and it would speed up that the chicken would drink. It's all organic. You know, it's not, there's no chemicals in it. It's Eco One. But it sped up the metabolism of the microbes in the gut of the bird. So they were producing more vitamins. The microbes were also doing more protein metabolism. And so the birds were putting on weight and with less weight or with less waste.
It sounds like an anti-parasitic too. Was it an anti-parasitic?
It's probiotic for sure. It's going to really help the health of the birds. Now you could do the same thing with steroids, beef them up, but then their heart would explode.
Absolutely.
And so it wasn't that. But a funny story was I had this stuff sitting in my lab to play around with. It's a little tiny bottle of it. And I was working with schools back then with setting up hydroponics labs and agriculture programs. And I went to one in Clarkston, Michigan. I went in there and talked about hydro. And they said, yeah, we're in the middle of doing a poultry contest right now for the state. And we're doing Cornish hens. I said, oh. I have this stuff in my lab, this organic stuff they add to the water. You want to try some of that? They go, yeah, sure, we'll try it. I said, okay. So I brought some over to them. It was already partway through the trial. So they just added the drops to the water, and they won silver for the whole state. They were second place. But I had to write a letter to the judges, because part of at Michigan State University that were running the contest, because part of the contest was we had to weigh the feed, they had to weigh the birds, had to do the graphs all the way through. So here it was, the plants were putting on weight, started adding those drops, like that. And they said, no, this is impossible. They accused them of using steroids. This isn't, that's why I had to write a letter. I said, no, no steroids. This is just more efficient nutrition. That's it. It's all organic, no steroids. So
is it brassica no steroid?
Huh?
Is a brass nose steroid considered a steroid as well? Like in that category?
That's a good question. I never thought of that, but it's really speeding up the metabolism of microbes is what it was doing.
You described the methodology I always talk to people about is you can either go faster or you can improve the situation, right? It's like what you're saying, pump the steroids and that's going faster, or you can make it more bioavailable and make it more efficient with what you're doing. And I love the thought process. Please continue.
You're right. It is efficiency. Mm-hmm. And that's where the bricks comes in. It's not the amount of nutrients they're getting. It's how efficiently the plants are taking them up and using them. And nature, by the way, nature has all the answers. They've been doing this on their own. Plants have been doing this on their own for millions of years without our help. But as human beings, I believe our place is to understand nature and work with nature to help to move them, give them a little nudge in the right direction at the right time. If we work against nature, there's negative side effects. You know, mm-hmm. sometimes you don't see them till later, but you know, a lot of these, some of the growth factors that they use are interrupt metabolic pathways. And in the end, they have negative effects on human beings. A lot of the fungicides, same way. But if we can improve the plant's natural resistance to pests and disease, we can improve the nutritional value of food, we can improve the medicinal value of our medicines. If we can create just the right amount of healthy stress, the plants are going to reward us over and over again. That's what they're there to help us, and we're there to help them. But we need them a lot more than they need us. Okay, well, get off my soapbox there, but
no, I love it. No, it's great.
Okay, and
people get to know you a little bit more when you do that. You know, you're just not another scientist in a lab coat. You have a heart, you know, and a soul to this. So thank you.
I do, and I really believe that there's a place and that we need it, a place for hydroponics in the future, recirculating systems, maybe adding some small amounts of these biostimulants. But there's another place we need to conserve our soil. We need to make more living soils. We need to make the land that we have more productive and protect that and protect it for the future. It's a limited resource. So there's a place for both, but when it gets to plant science, they all work the same at the microscopic level. You know,
like us in plants, we work very similar. Like our guts are similar to the soil biome, and they use a lot of the same elements that we do. It's kind of crazy how far it really goes into the elements of what we both use and utilize. And yeah. I feel like that bacteria is what connects us all. Yeah. It's like a huge internet system.
We couldn't survive without the bacteria that's in us. There are more bacterial cells in the human body than there are human cells.
Mm-hmm.
But we need them. They make essential elements, vitamins that we can't make. We couldn't live without. I'm going to make a prediction for the future that sometime in the future, they're going to look at our age, look back at our age, how we abused the antibiotics. And they're going to say, what were they thinking? They've saved a lot of lives. They're not bad, but we've overused them. I think the future in cancer research and a lot of other research is going to be in probiotics. It's going to be how
I completely agree.
Improve mm-hmm. The food that we eat today doesn't even have the close to the same nutritional value as the food that our grandparents ate.
Yeah.
So that's the prediction.
Unless you grow your own big gardens like myself, then we're packing my children with those vitamins and earth. And
a lot of it's like the sugar that's in everything. It ends up like killing all the microbes. It's like using, I don't know. It's like when people try to talk about using molasses in with your microbes every time. And it's kind of like, oh shoot. Sorry. Anyways, you can go ahead.
One time I did an experiment with microbes a long time ago. Remember, I've been doing this 25 years, so I have a couple of stories along the way. But I was brewing some microbes in the lab. I had my hot plate stirrer. I said, oh, let me try a few different sources. I used molasses for one. I used potato starch for one. I used some simple sugars for another one. You know, just brew them up. And the one that worked the best for the bacillus was the potato starch.
Hmm.
It was even better than the molasses. And I waited until it was fully, you know, like it was overflowing, the foam overflowing onto the table when I came in the morning. So I know it's 100% active. And I took a few drops in a dropper, and I put a couple of drops in each little Rockwell starter cube from that. So I inoculated the Rockwell, and then I put it up on the shelf, let it at room temperature dry out, sporulate. And then later on for my experiment, I added seeds to the ones that were inoculated and seeds to the ones that were uninoculated, okay? The ones that had a couple of drops of the microbes there, they germinated faster, and they had at least 3 or 4 days head start. I mean, it was obvious. So, I think I'm onto something. Then I went into my hydro system, and the ones that weren't inoculated caught up and passed the ones that were inoculated. Hmm. I went, what? And then I realized, so a little biofilm. I said, okay, they're getting the same nutrient, but now they have to share it. The microbes are eating it too. And they weren't quite as, they weren't quite as vigorous.
So you're saying the plants that didn't have the inoculant ended up robbing more of the microbes from the plants that were inoculated because it was in a recirculating system?
It was a recirculating system.
That's interesting. So it created, I keep going back to osmotic effect. It sounds like an osmotic effect at that point. And at that point, it even to the point where the plant gets so scared, it doesn't want to give them back. It even sounds like it's like, no, I got them. You can't have back. That's really interesting.
It is. I'm glad you brought that up because I'll tell you one. I mean, we're telling a lot of stories here, not doing much, but there was one time I was growing outdoor hydroponics. I had a 4-foot garden. It was basil back then. And it was in the summer and it was growing like unbelievable. I did 15 batches of pesto over the summer. It's not like growing in soil, right? So, but anyway, when it was warm, it had good full sun and breeze in the middle of the summer, it would go through 40 gallons of nutrients in 2 days. It'd be sucking it. But I checked my EC at the bottom 2 inches, and it was the same as when I started. So they were taking water and minerals at the same rate, growing like crazy. Okay, but here's the story. Then all of a sudden, we had some cold, kind of rainy, drizzly, overcast weather. The plant and the water wasn't, the level of the water wasn't going down at all because they weren't really taking up any water. But I checked my EC, it was going up.
Because the salts were becoming more water soluble, but they weren't being taken up.
No, because I already had them in there in the hydro solution at a certain level. The plant was leaking nutrients.
Oh, wow.
From the roots. Wow. See, it was growing, it was taking them up as fast as they could, taking up the water, taking up the nutrients, doing chemists. They were growing inches per day. And then all of a sudden, they have all this extra that they're burning inside the plant. All of a sudden, they didn't have it. So instead of using energy to hold on to those nutrients, they said, okay, just let it go. Just leak it through the roots. And then later, it would be available to them. But you won't find that in any of the books.
Your water reservoir, was it on a wick system?
No, it was NFT, nutrient film.
So it was constantly flowing then?
It's constantly flowing over the roots.
And you're telling me then so the plant released that back into the water. Wow. Holy interesting. That is an incredible experiment.
Because they're very efficient in their use of energy. Why burn energy to hold those salts that I can't use right now. So if they leak them from the roots, they're in the root zone still.
Was that a biological system?
What?
Was that a biology system with microbes?
No, that was hydroponics. It was
NFT. So sterile system.
It was a grow formula and outdoors, full sun.
Do you think that affects the theory of the flushing? Like, so the plant doesn't hold on to those excess nutrients, so it'll send them back down to the root zone. So it's not necessarily holding more than what it needs. Cause they've been doing some studies lately, like actual studies and doing blind studies, taste tests and all that, where they're finding that there really is no end difference in the flush or no flush.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering if that plays.
I don't know what your guys' feelings on it are, but I've always never been a big fan of flushing unless it's minor at the very end, last couple of days. It's because where all the flushing came up in the books is when they were over-fertilizing.
Exactly.
Over-fertilized nitrogen. You got to flush because you got to get rid of all the excess. So you overfeed and then you're really just dealing with the symptoms. And flushing at the end, if you're ramping down your nitrogen and you're spoon-feeding your other nutrients, you don't need to flush. In fact, I've seen studies where the non-flushing blind studies, they would they got better flavors without fleshy.
Nays, go ahead.
I was just going to say, it's almost like it's at its full reservoir of nutrient capacity to the full end. So its metabolism is able to go all the way to the very end rather than it having to perform necrosis on itself and start to eat and cannibalize itself for those nutrients. So it, at that point, its metabolism isn't that great. So it's less efficient.
Terpenes are flavor, right? Sugars make our taste good, right? And if it's giving it back to the soil, it's also giving up those sugars. So it's giving up the flavors. And that, I mean, I'm basic on that thought process, but the experiment just proved it. And in addition to that, just as another little keynote is I spent a lot of time on the extraction side. Product that we got that was flushed, we got more chlorophyll. Through our in process, a product that wasn't flushed, we had a cleaner product in initial pass throughs. So we would always look for product that wasn't flushed. That's when I came to the realization is that flushing would. I started to question it through the process of processing the material, and then I went back and looked at it again, and I was like, okay, I don't believe in flushing.
Well, I think I know what's going on there too with the chlorophyll. I learned years ago. That you have low to medium EC, in the salts that promotes vegetative growth. The medium to high EC restricts the vegetative growth. So if you're flushing for an extended period of time, you're lowering the EC, you're making it easier for the plant to take up water, and you're steering the plant vegetative. So it's going to want to make more chlorophyll. It's going to want to continue to make stems and leaves and grow. Instead, I want all those nutrients to go to the flowers or to be stored in the fruit. So you're really steering the plant the opposite at the end. Now, I did want to...
That was awesome.
Yeah, well, that made me kind of feel like, and I know genetics plays a role, but sometimes it just seems like there's so much more leaf matter on some of these flowers, and maybe... from them and with their nutrients. And then it's like, okay, flush at this week and then add this flush at this week, that they're kind of keep going back. And like what you're saying, reverting back to those, those stages, and I know genetics plays a role, but sometimes I'm just like, holy cow, there is a lot of leaf matter. Like, and then, there's times where I'm growing mine and I'm like, dude, there's barely like, it's just flower, it's like a more of a pure product. And man, that makes sense.
I like that. I think, you're right, though. It's the genetics are always number one.
Yeah.
When I'm looking at water analysis, I don't want to see more than 70 parts per million of chloride. That's kind of my limit. And no more than 50 parts per million of sodium.